In the previous weeks, you have learned how to handle a variety of challenges for infrastructure development, and you have seen how information and telecommunication technologies shape future infrastructure development. However, we have not focused yet on the context of infrastructure development. The world in which we develop the next generation of infrastructures is a world that is being urbanized at an unprecedented pace. Since 2008, more than half of the current 7 billion world population is living in cities. And by 2050, more than two-thirds of the world population will be urban. The latest UN estimates of world population growth point out that by 2100, planet Earth may be inhabited by as many as 12 billion people. And on the basis of the current urbanization trend, it seems a safe bet that most of them will be living in cities. So what is it that makes cities so attractive? Has infrastructure something to do with it? Is it good or bad news that cities are growing while rural areas are being depopulated? And what challenges do cities pose for infrastructure development, especially taking into account that the number of extremely large cities is increasing? Let us have a look at the pattern of urbanization worldwide. Looking at the percentage of the population of different countries that actually lives in cities, we see widely diverging figures. In Argentina, 92% of the population is urban, and more than 35% of the population lives in the largest city, Buenos Aires, where more than 13.6 million people live. And we see a similar pattern in Japan, although for different reasons, where 91% of the population is urban, with 32% of the population living in Tokyo, which is a megacity of more than 37 million people. In fact, the largest metropolitan area in the world. In 2012, according to an urban area's population and density update by New Geography, 26 urban areas in the world qualified as megacities. So what defines an urban area, a city or a metropolitan area? According to New Geography, an urban area is an area of continuous urban development within a metropolitan area. An urban area or an urban agglomeration is the physical expression of a city. It is what you can see and touch. A concentration of built environment, homes, offices, industrial facilities, all types of infrastructure, everything that is clearly visible in a satellite view, especially at night. It is the physical environment where large numbers of people live and work in close proximity to each other. The economic and functional expression of a city is the metropolitan area. A metropolitan area is defined as more or less an economic region, the combination of urban, suburban, and rural areas which together comprise the labor market of the region. In Wikipedia, you will see a metropolitan area defined as a region consisting of a densely populated urban core and its less densely populated surrounding territories, suburban areas, rural areas. And all those areas share industry, infrastructure, and housing. Metropolitan areas include one or more urban areas, as well as satellite cities, towns, and intervening rural areas that are socio-economically tied to the urban core, as typically is measured by commuting patterns. Hence, a metropolitan area usually comprises multiple jurisdictions. Municipalities, counties, districts, even states and nations. Changing social, economic, and political institutions have made metropolitan areas increasingly relevant as socio-economic entities and as cultural identities. How come that vast countries like Australia or Argentina are among the most urbanized countries in the world? Australia is largely empty, as 89% of its people huddle together in large urban agglomerations on its coasts. Why do 92% of the people in Argentina prefer to live in cities, with 35% of its population huddled together in Buenos Aires. Apparently, cities are an attractive habitat for the human species. And without going into psychological explanations, I think it is clear that for most people, the opportunities that cities offer for social interaction, for jobs, education, cultural activities, and so on, outweigh the disadvantages of living in cities. And indeed, the work of Jeffrey West and Louise Bettencourt and others at the Santa Fe Institute shows that the productivity of cities increases with the size of the urban population. The larger the city, the more innovation and wealth it produces per capita. But the productivity does not increase linearly with the size of the population. It increases in a supralinear fashion. Doubling the size of the city systematically increases wealth and income with a scaling factor of 1.15. In other words, doubling the size of the city leads to more than double the productivity of the city, as we see an increase of 15% in, for example, wages and number of patents per capita. So the city is an intriguing organism. Whereas biological organisms scale sublinearly, with their metabolism growing slower as the size of the organism increases, cities exhibit an opposite behavior. Their metabolic rate increases supralinearly with increasing size of the urban system. Looking back into history, we see that natural infrastructure dictated the places where successful human settlement occurred. The rivers Euphrates, Tigris, and Nile enabled civilization, and with it, cities to emerge in Mesopotamia and Egypt around 6000 before Christ. Cities allow for a smart division of tasks and hence economic specialization, which increases productivity and generates more wealth for all to share. Already then, men interfered with man-made infrastructure for a variety of essential functions, such as water storage, flood control, and irrigation. And many of the techniques developed then are still in use today. People's choice to live in cities has always been a trade-off between opportunity and risk. Cities offered protection against enemies, but also risk, for example, the risk of contagious diseases. In the past, many cities were situated in such a way that natural infrastructure posed a barrier to invading enemy forces. As an example, Machu Picchu in Peru. As we can see today, with more and more megacities situated in flood-prone coastal zones, the location of cities is generally a trade-off between accessibility and safety. Coastal zones and river deltas offer premium shipping and trading opportunities, and therewith opportunities for industry and other economic activity, but at the same time, they are vulnerable to flooding. One of the most extreme examples of such risks is the western part of the Netherlands, which is situated below sea level. Dike ring 14 in this area is one of a total of 53 dike rings protecting the Netherlands from flooding. And it protects a region where 3.5 million people generate approximately 65% of the Dutch GDP. Urbanization patterns in the world differ widely. While Japan and Europe show very low urbanization rates, below 1%, the annual increase in urban population is above 1% in most parts of the world. And it is a staggering 2.3% and 2.4% in China and India, respectively. In Europe, megacities are the exception rather than the rule. Only Paris is a true megacity. In Germany and the Netherlands, for example, with 74% and 83% of the population living in urban agglomerations, we see that the population is fairly equally distributed over a large number of relatively small cities. But in Japan and Argentina, the urban population is very much concentrated in very few, much larger cities. And by far the largest number of megacities is found in Asia. 16 of today's 26 megacities, each with a population of over 10 million, are located in Asia. we see staggering population densities there, up to 30,000 people per square kilometers in Mumbai, India, and more than 44,000 people per square kilometers in Dhaka, Bangladesh. Looking at these patterns, we are tempted to speculate that the growth of megacities is an autocatalytic process. As the opportunities increase supralinearly with the size of the city becomes a stronger magnet for people and talent as it grows. Compare the NASA satellite images of the Pearl River Delta. The first one dates from October 1979, where you will see Guangzhou, the Guangdong state capital, as a very compact city. But since then, Shenzhen started to develop as the first special economic zone in China, implemented by Deng Xiaoping. On the NASA picture of January 2003, you can see how much difference that made. The Pearl River Delta is today home to approximately 45 million people, and the previously disparate urban agglomerations are now merging into a region-wide metropolis, a true megalopolis, which is moreover strongly interconnected with Hong Kong. Now, is the current trend towards urbanization good or bad news for food, energy, and water security? Is it good or bad news for the environment? What are its needs in terms of infrastructure development? How can infrastructure cater for better city, better life, which was the slogan of the Shanghai World Expo in 2010? Is infrastructure the key to the factor 8 efficiency improvement in productivity question? We will try to find some answers in the next module. Stay with us, and thank you very much for watching.